Assalamu alaikum everyone. I'm Hania Rifit, director of YJE Legal Conference, and I will be co-moderating today's session. I welcome all panelists and all our audience who have joined us today. I will formally begin by introducing the Youth General Assembly and the YJE Legal Conference. Youth General Assembly is an autonomous assembly that has been formed in order to provide a credible platform that instigates the true sense of policy and strategy making, equitable administration, and non-customary legislative public speaking by empowering enthusiasm youth for being the future ambassadors and democrats. The aim is to inculcate the convening and confronting qualities amongst the youth to expand their perspective and knowledge regarding true democracy and parliamentary politics. Keeping up with its tradition, YG has organized the 6th Legal Conference. The aim of this conference is to ensure the role of youth as a driving force behind justice and extend its role in creating a bridge between textual knowledge and practical implementation of the law to empower the youth. In pursuance of our goal, we introduce our panel for the first session on skills for young lawyers. Joining us today is the very dynamic Madam Sara Tahir, who is the Dean of the International College for Legal Studies and is a World University of London worldwide recognized tutor. She's a digital dispute resolution specialist and has over 17 years of experience in the legal academia. My co-moderator, Ramna, will now introduce Madam Sana Pirzada and Abiha Haider. Ramna, you're not audible, unfortunately. Still, there's an issue.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. So, hello everyone. This is Ramna Saeed, and I'm working with Youth General Assembly as Assistant Secretary General, and we are honored to have.
Ramna, unfortunately, internet has a lot of issues. So I think I'll take the honor of introducing Madam Sana Pirzada. Madam Sana Pirzada is the founder of the Virtual Legal Advisory. She completed her LLB honors from King's College London and an LLM from London School of Economics. She was thereafter called to the Bar of England and Wales by the Honorable Lincoln's Inn Society. She has a diverse experience in practicing law in England and in Pakistan as well. She also has a significant experience in legal academia. She works with a well-renowned organization on anti-trafficking. Joining us today also is Madam Abiha Haider, who is a 2-time Guinness World Record holder and a lawyer. We would really like all our panelists to introduce themselves so that our audience can also duly benefit from how you from your innovative experience. You can have Madam Sara, and then Madam Sana, and then Madam Abiha.
Thank you, Hania. Thank you very much. I think you've given a brief introduction, but in order for relevance to the topic we have today, I would want students, the youth generally, to know what else I have been involved in, what my qualifications are, so that it becomes relevant here. So essentially, I'm the Dean of International College for Legal Studies, and this institution was created to make sure that not only is education, legal education, imparted to the youth, but also to bridge the gaps that I felt during my 17 years that I've worked with another institution providing University of London education. I used to feel that there's a gap, and I felt that there's a need, and which is why I have to bridge that gap. Now, why did I feel that gap was there? Because every day I used to interact with students. So students come to me for counseling because I've done not only my LLB, but also my LLM from University of London. I am, in addition, an ADR specialist. I have my trainings from ADR ODR International UK. So students not only used to come to me for advice regarding law, but also ADR, which is very closely connected to law. And during my years, I felt whenever I'm counseling students, I would feel they feel lost. There is no plan that they have. So you join the degree either because your parents say that you should join it, or you feel that, you know, I have very good argument skills and I should be a lawyer, you know, so aage career path nahi banao. So which is why I feel there is a need for students to be told that you need to have a very clear path, and for us as teachers and counselors to guide them how to go towards that career path. What are the kind of skills that a lawyer needs to develop, and what all, how all can we help the student during the course of the 3 years or the 5-year degree that the student has, for instance, by creating meaningful relationships with all around you, whether they are your teachers, whether they are your students, because these are the relationships that are going to be helping you in the future. Also finding good mentors. You know, students in third year often come to me and they're lost and they're like, we don't know aage kya karna hai. But if you have been able to, and your teachers have been able to assist you in finding good mentors, and you know, these are the mentors who are going to help me, I think it helps a student a lot. So that support system needs to be there. And you also need to make sure that you're not just teaching a subject, you have to make sure students also get practical legal knowledge, where the legal clinics come in. So I feel this is what I have been doing during the 17 years that I have spent in the academia, whether with respect to ADR or with respect to law in general. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam. We've just seen that Barrister Salman Safdar has joined. We extend our heartiest and warm welcome to you, Barrister Salman Safdar. Barrister Salman is the leading advocate of the Supreme Court and a world-renowned criminal practitioner. He graduated from the London School of Economics and was thereafter called to the Bar of England and Wales by the Honorable Lincoln's Inn. He has a vast experience of practice in both England and Pakistan. Barrister Salman, I will begin the formal session with the first question for today for all our panelists. In today's time and age, if I say it's raining lawyers, it might not be an overstatement because of the very high number of law graduates per year. However, the number of adequately skilled and successful names in the legal fraternity is abysmally low, as a result of which frequently questions have been raised about the quality of legal education in Pakistan. We would like to know how our panelists assess the quality of legal education relative to international standards. What exactly are the loopholes according to them? We'll have Barrister Salman, followed by Madam Sana, and then Madam Sara and Madam Abiha. I'm afraid we cannot hear Barrister Salman. Sir, your internet is lagging. We'll have Madam Sana's response on that first, and then we'll come back to Barrister Salman.
Hania, first of all, thank you so much for this kind invitation. I'm absolutely humbled by that, and I'm honored to be here amongst such esteemed panelists. So with regards to this particular question, there's a lot to say, and I'm not going to say much because I know that the other panelists also have to contribute. So with regards to the legal education abroad and in Pakistan, I have to say, being part of the academic world in Pakistan and actually being a law lecturer over here, I've taught at 3 universities in Karachi so far. Two follow the local LLB programs, and one is following the University of London program. There is no comparison between the legal education abroad and the legal education here for a number of reasons, and I'll just briefly state those. Now, first of all, when we look at education abroad, because I studied in the UK for over a decade, the lecturers, and I'm not going to say this generally, obviously in Pakistan you have a mixture. Some lecturers are very competent, very highly qualified, they know how to teach, but there are many that I have observed who don't really know how to impart those skills. Abroad, obviously you have that level of competence, which I have personally seen when I was taught by lecturers over there. Secondly, we have in Pakistan, when I've been teaching at local universities, there are 3-hour long sessions, at least at the universities that I taught, which I personally think is quite an obsolete method. And in the UK, there was this entire group of students, say about 300. So when we had lectures, all those 300 students were in one auditorium, which was fine. But then they were broken down further into seminars with around 20 students, and even further into tutorials with about 6 to 8 students. So they, all the students had that one-to-one attention. I was recently teaching students online ever since COVID started. This is a local university in Karachi. And I had about 60 or so students, and I could tell that obviously with the cameras off and the mics on mute, hardly any of the students were even paying attention to what I was saying. And I, my main criticism, of course, is that these 3-hour long sessions per week with about, with so many students is not beneficial. So I think that in terms of the class structures, that is something that needs to change. The duration of the classes needs to change. Another point is that in foreign countries, you have access to libraries, physical libraries with a diverse range of resources. And students in foreign countries are taught at a very early age to make use of libraries. In Pakistan, there are some universities that have libraries, but again, the books are very limited. The bookshops, the legal bookshops themselves are very limited with very limited books. Again, online resources, when you're taking a University of London program, you have access to Westlaw, Lexis, etc., which is excellent. But when it comes to local degrees and students who are pursuing a local LLB or an LLM program, they're again struggling in terms of access, having access to these online resources. So this is another problem that exists over here. So again, I think that in terms of what our system lacks in terms of the educational quality, first of all, the competence in terms of teachers, the admission criteria when it comes to giving admission to students. I've noticed in some universities that they'll just accept anyone, irrespective of their level of competence, their level of determination to a legal career. So that is something that has actually been looked at over the years, but further reforms are necessary. You need to make more resources available over here in terms of physical libraries, online libraries. And I think that there needs to be more emphasis on practical exercises as well, such as mooting and public speaking. Speaking in classrooms needs to be compulsory. They need to be able to practice their speaking skills because this is what they need to rely on as future lawyers. So I, again, have a lot to say, but I'm going to stop here just to be fair to my other panelists.
Thank you very much, madam, for your response. Barrister Salman, can you hear us? If we could have your response to this question, I would repeat it. How do you assess the quality of legal education relative to international standards in Pakistan? What exactly are the loopholes according to you? It seems that he does not have a stable internet connection. Sir, can you hear us? It would be absolutely fine, sir, if you reconnect as well. He will reconnect very soon. We'll have Madam Abiha's response on this first, and then we'll move to Madam Sara.
Thank you, Hania. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. And I'm absolutely honored to be part of such profound panel right now and be a panelist amongst such great minds. And for me, definitely there's one thing where I draw the difference between our local Pakistani law or the Pakistani structure, whether it's an international law being taught in Pakistan or the local law and the law being taught in UK. The major thing for me is that we do not focus on providing practical knowledge to the students. I being myself an LLB graduate from University of London, and right now I'm about to complete my LLM from the University of London. There's this major lack which we as students experience. And as you know, we have all seen that, you know, in abroad, when the legal students are being taught, the lecturers actually engage them in the actual cases, on the actual field. They're actually given the exercises to break a case, to bring legal precedents on the case, to find a new way for the lawyer. But for us, I don't think we as students, we are only confined towards the book knowledge. That is what we give to our students. I have also been teaching some core subjects of LLB to my students, but this is unfortunately the thing which us in Pakistan are following, that we are just confined towards book knowledge, and we do not actually bring our students out from the classrooms towards the actual cases. The lecturers do not take them as interns for their 3 to 5 years in the degree, for them to learn the actual law. And that is when we experience that once the LLB student is graduated from the university, whether it's a foreign university or whether it's a Pakistani university, the student is actually clueless on their first day to the kacheri or on their first day to a law firm. They're actually clueless that what is the penal code, what is the how do you write a writ petition, how do you file a bail application. Those very minor things, we do not teach our students the practical knowledge of the law. So that is where I draw my major comparison or concern in between the foreign education and the Pakistani education being taught in Pakistan. Thank you.
Absolutely. Even I would relate to this. We will have Ms. Tara's response on this.
Thank you so much, Hania. I think I would definitely agree with what my esteemed panelists have just said, Sana and Abiha. These are things that, you know, I've been seeing in the 17 years that I've worked, and I've been trying to work on them as well. So the thing is, what has happened over time is that, unfortunately, institutions which are imparting legal education treat it more like a business rather than thinking that you have young minds in your hand and that you have to focus not on just giving them a degree, but to, you know, there's so many elements, like I said in the beginning, associated with it. Now, Sana was mentioning about the duration, you know, for instance, you have a lecture for, I've seen 2 hours, she must have seen 3 hours as well. How is it possible to retain that much in 2 hours? Now I'll give you an example. I did a degree, postgraduate certificate of teaching and learning in higher education, which is why I'm a University of London worldwide recognized tutor. Now, that degree was eye-opening for me as well. We are under this, I would say there is this overconfidence, you know, okay, maine 17 saal padhaya hai, mujhe sab kuch aata. That's not how it happens. Experience is one thing. There's a theory to it that you need to understand. Kisi bhi field mein, there's expert opinion. There are people who have worked for years and know how to. So knowing law is one thing, but knowing how to teach a student is totally another thing. So we did this exercise whereby we were told to, you know, look at this video and asked how much of it could we retain. 15 minutes ke baad, a person reaches its peak retention, you know, and that's after 15 minutes, you're supposed to just go down. You don't retain as much after 15 minutes. So we were taught that, you know, after 15 minutes, take a break. After 10 minutes, take a break. This is not how we teach. Usually we just take a break in between, you know, 45 minutes, take a 5 minute break, please come back, you know. So these are not machines that we are teaching. We have to make sure we are not just covering syllabus. We have to make sure they know it, and then you have to know how to apply it. Now, as far as University of London is concerned, I know that guides have been made in a way that there are exercises after every 10 minutes. But are we actually teaching it that way? You know, do we stop after those 10 minutes and tell students, okay, this is time to apply your mind? Another thing that I feel is an issue, and again, I learned from my degree in teaching and learning, was there is a very different methodology when it comes to teaching large groups and when it comes to teaching small groups. Small groups, we feel comfortable. Oh, we are giving one-to-one attention. Some universities have, lectures, but then they have tutorials even here in Pakistan. But are we actually teaching them the way lectures or tutorials are supposed to be given? I feel it's just a name. Okay, we offer lectures, we offer tutorials. you offer very different kind of activities when you're teaching small groups, and very different because of in large groups. The focus always is learning and not teaching, making student independent learners, making them apply their mind. Only will they be able to, each one of them have personalities of their own and be able to, you know, do something in the future. If you just teach something and just leave it, this is not, you're just, you know, making sure ki aap apna kaam kar diye upar upar ka, you're not actually going beyond it. So yes, libraries is a factor as well, as you know, Sana has mentioned, and that there's a dearth of that. But I don't feel there's a dearth of good teachers in Pakistan. What is lacking is their training. Na to teachers realize karte hain, na the people who are providing education, legal education, do they realize that you need to have a separate training as a teacher, not just as a lawyer. So those are my two cents. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your response. Barrister Salman, can you hear us now? He joined back, but I don't think if he can hear us. So you were unmuted, now you mute. We would really appreciate to have Sir Salman's response on this as well, but it seems as if he does not have a stable internet at the moment. So we can hear you a bit, but your voice is breaking. So you can reconnect again if you feel that would help stabilize your internet connection. We would move to the next question. Ramna, if you can take the floor now. Well, I think that's the drawback of having like illegal conferences. The internet connections pose quite a lot of issues. Ramna, we cannot hear you.
Hey, can you hear me now?
Yeah, perfect. Absolutely
okay.
Fine.
So I would like to ask a question from Ma'am Sana Pirzada, that what do you think that how integration of technology in legal education can benefit the future lawyers? What do you say about this?
So with the onset of COVID, we've seen pretty much everything switch from a physical setting to a virtual setting, which is one of the reasons why I did set up my platform called Virtual Legal Advisory. Now, it's become absolutely essential because we've seen in other parts of the world, namely in the UK and in other countries, that when COVID started, meetings with clients, even the courts also went online. Now, this is something that in the years to come may even happen in other parts of the world, namely in Pakistan as well, because we don't really know what the COVID situation is going to be like in the coming years. So in terms of having sort of IT skills, in terms of being able to adapt to technology, these are skills that every young lawyer should possess. I would also say that even some very basic skills like being well-versed with all the Microsoft dimensions, even things as simple as Word, PowerPoints, Excel, every young lawyer should be having qualifications, and they should have expertise in these areas. They should know how to be able to utilize legal apps and other sorts of apps as well, like Zoom. I mean, Zoom is something that has become so common now, but even so, there are many people who don't even know what Zoom is. So these are the sort of things that every student should be able to to master. And technology in the coming years is going to play a very vital role, especially in the legal field, given the climate that we're in. So it is pertinent for students to be able to balance that.
Yeah, very rightly said. So I would move to Ma'am Abiha. So as you have recently graduated, as you mentioned earlier, so there's a punchline that that recently emerged that unpaid internships are the forced labor. So what would be your views regarding that?
For me, I clearly very openly say that unpaid internships is directly exploitation, you know, exploitation of young graduates. I've been very vocal about it recently, since last year when I graduated, because me myself, I've been experiencing this thing that, you know, once we graduate, after studying so hard for like 3 years, or for the Pakistani program, it's like 5 years, you know, students need to have some sort of motivation to step into the legal field. I don't think that any one of us expect that we should be paid in like 5 figures, or, you know, 80,000, 90,000 or stuff like that. But at least some sort of remuneration would help the student to have their motivation intact. Plus, you know, times like these, which we are facing right now, COVID has been extremely hard on the students as well, and their mental health as well. And on top of that, when you graduate, you have this sort of responsibility that now you're a graduate, you have to have your own finances enabled on your own self. You can't, you know, just keep on asking money from your parents even after you are graduated. So it's forced labor, it's exploitation. I would definitely say that. Plus, even today, I was talking to my friend. I was out on a lunch, and we were talking about this issue happened here in Islamabad in a very, very well-known law firm. A girl we know, she was working in as a research associate in that law firm since a year now, and she was very good with her work, amazingly, you know, coping up with all the deadlines and stuff. And after a year, when all her colleagues spoke to their main managing partner that now she should be started paying, because that now they should pay her, what was the answer? Imagine that. Why should I pay when I have so many standing right at the doors of my law firm willing to work for me for free? Because we have so many students coming out of the universities each year, and every one of us wants to have some sort of experience. So the employers now have this thing in mind that, okay, students need to have experience, we would give it out for free, and hum apna kaam karenge. You know, we don't at this legal firm, our legal firms, we do not have any working time. We would go to the office at 8 a.m. and we would be expected to work at the office till 7 p.m. and at the home till 12 a.m. or 1 a.m. And the weekends also are occupied by your boss. You know, you have your research work, or you have your case files to be prepared on the weekends, but there is no money involved at all. Plus, there's one more thing. Whenever there's new job opening, even for an internship, every job opening requires a year experience or a 2 year experience for the new graduates. So when you're not giving us the proper chance to step up in the legal field, for us to gain our knowledge and for us to get the requisite jobs, where would that 2 year experience come in our hands or in our CV? So I guess these are very pertinent issues for us to discuss right now, and not even to discuss. I guess we should actually formulate some sort of connection with these, so that these exploitation of young graduates, these exploitation and this forced labor should end. This forced labor should end, and the students should get their pay, which they are very much well deserved.
Thank you, Madam Abiha, for your response. We now have with us Barrister Salman. So we were talking about how a certain punchline has emerged that says that unpaid internships are forced labor. I would extend it a bit further. The dole of recent law graduates also is quite similar. They're frequently seen complaining about hard working conditions in the legal fraternity. How do you assess the situation, especially when they're coming from meager, humble economic backgrounds and coming from small cities, moving to big cities, and then they're not able to find a sustainable, viable stipend or salary in the legal fraternity? How do you assess the situation? It's very unfortunate that we're not able to hear him. I think he will reconnect. So, Madam Sara, I'll shift to you. the same question. How do you assess the situation of recent law graduates and their complaints and their laments about the extremely harsh working conditions, long hours, little to no remuneration or anything of that sort?
Thank you, Hanya. So I actually felt everything that Abhiha was saying. It was coming straight from a fresh graduate, and I think everyone will resonate. I resonate with whatever she said resonates with me. The thing is, I feel as far as I am concerned, when I think what is lacking, yes, on one part you can say what is lacking is how the law firms are treating you and how, you know, they shouldn't be treating you like this. But I think there is also a problem as far as the training of lawyers is concerned. We are not training our young lawyers properly in that sense that we are not teaching them not to undersell themselves. We are not giving them enough confidence and training that, you know, when you go. Now, agar aap example dete hain that you are saying, I think Abhiha mentioned ke they are saying ke why should we hire you or keep you or pay you because there are so many who are willing to work for free. My question is, why are they willing to work for free? Where have we gone wrong in training them of how, you know, it's another thing as a student internship aap kar rahe ho while during the course of the degree. You have completed a 3-year or 5-year degree and the student has not been taught, unfortunately, by us that don't undersell yourself. Be confident in what you are asking for. So I feel, agar aap itne long hours padha rahe hain, these are long kaam karwa rahe hain, these are long hours you're giving them, you're getting something out of them, or you wouldn't have been taking their work for such long hours. Somebody has worked with you for a year, there must have been some benefit you were getting. Then it doesn't make sense. You have a choice, you have a clear choice. Somebody doesn't work, you don't need to keep someone. If somebody is working, there should be a clear pay structure. Again, I feel this is unfair where you say, and this is something that, you know, my graduates often complain of, everything is as a condition 2 to 3 years work experience. What is there for newcomers? So I feel there should be a scale. I'm not saying pay them the same as somebody with 2 or 3 years experience, but have a scale. If somebody does not have work experience, this is where we start you with this kind of salary package. Unfortunate thing is, it's not just law firms, anywhere, even in academia, we don't have proper structures where we have a scale. This is how you start and this is where you're going to go. If you have a good structure in place, whether in academia, whether in law firms, a student or a potential young lawyer sees room for growth, and phir ye jo complaint bhi aati hai na, bachcha job shifting kar gaya, that job shifting complaint will also not be there because there is incentive. So I think we need to incentivize our young lawyers. Thank you.
Absolutely. Salman sahab, aapko hamari awaaz aa rahi
hai? Hania, can you see him? He's not properly visible, I guess. Not audible.
Yes,
enough.
I think this today, and it's very, very unfortunate. It's very unfortunate. So we'll shift the question to Madam Sana, and then Sir Salman, can you hear us? His video is also paused. So we'll have Madam Sana's response on this, and then maybe Barrister Salman can help stabilize his internet.
Okay, so firstly, I completely concur with Abhiha and Ms. Sara, and I think that they have a lot more experience than me in terms of addressing this particular issue. Now, from my perspective, when it comes to unpaid internships, we used to do a lot of these in the UK, and I agree with Ms. Sara that when you're studying at that time, if you do a mini pupillage, which is what it's called in the UK, for a week, it could be paid, it could be unpaid. Even if it's unpaid, it's beneficial for you, even if you work in a law firm for, say, a month or so in an unpaid position, it's beneficial. But anything longer than a month, I would say, requires remuneration. Now, I have heard from some of my students who I taught a couple of years ago and who've now been working in law firms. And these students are now lawyers and no longer students. They are paid, but even then, the sort of things that they complain about in law firms, you know, the insane working hours and the attitudes of the seniors, it's all absolutely appalling. And I think that what's actually lacking in our system is a proper code of conduct, a professional code of conduct and ethics for lawyers. lawyers, seniors and juniors. And I think that if that were in place, and if you had the Bar Council and these rules regarding transparency, accountability, I don't think any of this would have been happening. Because in the UK, for example, if any chamber or any law firm does anything which is contrary to any of the regulations, if they violate any laws, if they discriminate against the interns or employees or whatever, or if any of their practices seem abusive, you can always complain to the Law Society and Bar Council, and they do take action. And that is something that really needs to be done in Pakistan as well, that if a law firm is abusing interns or employees, if they're not paying them properly, if they're not behaving in a proper manner, there needs to be a proper complaint mechanism in place. But again, I would say that it varies again from one law firm to another. Not every law firm is inhumane. And if you're doing an unpaid internship for a limited period of time at a law firm and they're treating you with respect, you're gaining knowledge, you're gaining relevant work experience, well and good. But of course, as I said, 1 to 2 months is more than enough. But if it's beyond 2 or 3 months, then definitely you need to get paid at least a stipend. So that's what I'm going to say.
Thank you so much for your response. And I pretty much agree with it also. So if they're treating you with respect and it's only a 1 month long internship, then maybe it's fine. But when it's longer than that, then there has to be some monetary compensation, a small stipend. And even with Ms. Sara's stance, it was very amazing that a pay scale has to be introduced. Maybe that will help. With Barrister Salman, Ramna,
I hope you can hear me now. Could you please confirm that? And first of all, though, I'm extremely sorry, and my apologies to all the participants today. But you know, patiently I heard all of you, and I understand what the issue was and what was being discussed. I heard the disgruntled and dissatisfied interns who are, you know, not too happy with the pupil masters not paying anything. Madam Sara ne Karachi se jo baat ki, wo badi zabardast ki, and I think I'm also experiencing that. It's very challenging to teach students these days when you are online. There's connectivity issue, and you know the screens are off. So these are challenging days and challenging times. I will just give you, since I've missed out on the major portion of, you know, what was discussed, I'll just contribute my two cents as to what I have to say about this whole, whatever was discussed so far. I have about 20 years of teaching experience, and I am also a litigator. I practice criminal law. It's been 20 years. This is what I do day in, day out. And I also interact with variety of students who are directionless, who are basically on a lookout for summer placements. Jo aapka sabse pehla sawal tha, main uski taraf zarur aana chahunga ke legal education, what is the difference of studying abroad, and what is it that is lacking in the system? Ek to main ye kahunga ke Pakistan mein jo curriculum ka jo focus hai wo एनालिटिकल रीजनिंग और जो माइंड अप्लाई करने वाला पार्ट है वो उस पर इतना फोकस नहीं किया जाता. ऑफ कोर्स फॉरेन क्वालिफिकेशन, फॉरेन डिग्रीज, इट इज एन एज, बट आई वुड से जितना बाहर से पढ़ के आना एडवांटेज है, उतना ही बड़ा डिसएडवांटेज है. आई हैव सीन पीपल हु हैव डन देयर सिंपल एलएलबी डिग्रीज फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान doing better, understanding the legal world better than foreign return students with Harvard, Columbia, Yale, Oxford, Cambridge degrees. The major difference between qualification here and abroad are the skills. Pakistan mein on your advocacy skills, on your drafting skills, on your conference skills, on your negotiation skills, no attention is paid. And eventually, when you land in court, these are the skills which you basically require. So, agar hum somehow, not all of us are lucky to get an admission abroad. going abroad international now is become increasingly difficult and challenging. Variety of reasons. Number one, our currency has deteriorated, and jo currency devaluation hai Pakistan mein, wo itni significant ho gayi hai ki it is not affordable anymore to go abroad. COVID has further complicated the issues. So I think we have to settle down with whatever. Visas are a big issue. Students are very unlucky. You know, at the 11th hour, they are unable to take their flights. So if we focus in Pakistan and settle with whatever these standards and with whatever is available in Pakistan locally, and try to improve our skills in Pakistan. Now, how can we do that? Sabse pehli baat, मैं कहूंगा दैट इंस्टीट्यूट्स शुड हैव रादर देन हैविंग वन वीक ऑफ मॉक ट्रायल्स एंड एडवोकेसी सेशंस. दिस प्रोफेशन इज ऑल अबाउट पब्लिक स्पीकिंग, इट्स ऑल अबाउट ऑरेटरी, इट्स ऑल अबाउट एडवोकेसी. सो योर कॉन्फिडेंस टू स्पीक, दिस इज वन शॉर्टकमिंग विच आई सी इन डेब्यूटेंट्स, इन फ्रेश लॉ स्टूडेंट्स व्हेन दे एंटर द फील्ड. कॉन्फिडेंस नहीं है बोलने का, और बोलोगे नहीं तो पैसे कैसे कमाओगे. तो पीपल कम टू यू फॉर योर एबिलिटी टू प्रेजेंट द केस, फॉर योर एबिलिटी टू स्पीक. वो उसके ऊपर कोई काम ही नहीं होता. और जरूरी नहीं है दैट यू हैव टू प्रेजेंट इट, यू हैव टू स्पीक इन इंग्लिश. आवर मदर टंग इज उर्दू. जजेस इनकरेज यू, इवन इफ यू आर टॉकिंग सेंस एंड इफ यू आर प्रिपेयर्ड, यू कैन प्रेजेंट योर केस इन उर्दू. नोबडी विल रेप्रिमांड यू, नोबडी विल स्टॉप यू. सो असल बात जो दिक्कत आ रही है, स्किल्स पर काम नहीं हो रहा. एक हफ्ते का जो मॉक ट्रायल का सेशन है या डिबेटिंग कोचिंग सेशन है, वो कुछ नहीं बिगाड़ता स्टूडेंट्स का. तो थोड़ा सा अगर उनका ड्राफ्टिंग की उनको अलिफ बे नहीं पता होती, और जब वो प्रोफेशन में आते हैं तो आके उन्होंने सिर्फ एक लॉ डिग्री पढ़ी होती है, प्रिंसिपल्स पढ़े होते हैं, दे डोंट नो व्हाट टू डू. मैं स्टेप बाय स्टेप, सिंस काफी चीजें डिस्कस हुई, मैं सारी बातें जो है वो करता जाऊं तो वो बेहतर है. सो लॉ डिग्री बाहर की होना, मैं आपको 100 लीडिंग लॉयर्स बता देता हूं, सिंपल LLB डिग्रीज है उनके पास, फॉरेन क्वालिफिकेशन नहीं है उनके पास. फॉरेन क्वालिफिकेशन इज अ डबल एज स्वॉर्ड, जितना आपके हक में उतना आपके खिलाफ भी है. तो वो पीपल थिंक इट्स गोइंग टू बी अ स्मूथ राइड व्हेन यू लैंड इन पाकिस्तान विद योर फॉरेन डिग्रीज एंड टाइटल्स, एंड देयर वुड बी क्यूज ऑफ क्लाइंट्स वेटिंग फॉर यू. दैट विल नॉट हैपन. तो यहां पर दिक्कत सबसे ज्यादा जो मैंने देखी है लॉयर्स में, नंबर वन कंसिस्टेंसी नहीं है, नंबर दो डिसिप्लिन नहीं है, नंबर तीन शॉर्टकट्स चाहिए, ओवरनाइट सक्सेस चाहिए, पेशेंस और परसेवेरेंस खत्म हो चुकी है. लॉ का प्रोफेशन, मैंने आई हर्ड मैडम सारा तारड स्पीकिंग, उन्होंने अच्छी बात की. आई थिंक द मोस्ट क्रूशल डिसीजन व्हेन यू लैंड इन पाकिस्तान और व्हेन यू लैंड द लीगल अरीना एंड यू स्टार्ट योर प्रोफेशनल करियर इज सिलेक्शन ऑफ योर प्यूपल मास्टर एंड योर मेंटोर. काम किससे सीखना है, और अगर सीखना है तो जो हमारी बहन नाराज थी कि लॉयर्स कुछ देते नहीं है, जब सीखना है तो उस्ताद कहता है कि अभी तो मेरा टाइम वेस्ट कर रहे हो, और जिस दिन अलिफ बे आ गई उसके बाद आपने मेरा चेंबर छोड़ देना है. तो एक साल का जो पीरियड होता है, द फर्स्ट सिक्स एंड द सेकंड सिक्स, ये एक बड़ी अपॉर्चुनिटी होती है कि किसी चेंबर में जगह मिल जाए आपको काम सीखने की. आपके मैं इस लीगल कॉन्फ्रेंस में मैं एक बात कहना चाहूंगा कि जितने लॉ स्टूडेंट्स हैं हु वेस्ट देयर समर हॉलीडेज नॉट सिक्योरिंग प्यूपलेज शॉर्ट टर्म इंटर्नशिप्स फॉर देम, व्हाट अ मिस्टेक दे आर मेकिंग. हैंडफुल ऑफ लॉ फर्म्स, कराची से मैडम सारा कंफर्म कर दें, लाहौर से मैं कंफर्म कर देता हूं, नो मोर देन 15-20 लॉ फर्म्स, डिसेंट लॉ फर्म्स, जहां पर वेर यू हैव एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू एक्सेल एंड टू मेक अ डिफरेंस. सो एक अनार 100 बीमार, 20 लॉ फर्म्स हैं और 2000 लॉ स्टूडेंट अगर फील्ड में आता है तो किस किस को अकोमोडेट किया जाए. ओनली द ब्राइटेस्ट, ओनली द मोस्ट प्रॉमिसिंग, ओनली द मोस्ट कमिटेड, ओनली द मोस्ट डिसिप्लिन्ड विल मेक इट एंड विल सर्वाइव. आई हैव सीन लम स्टूडेंट कमिंग ज्वाइनिंग, और ये बात नहीं है कि पीछे से बड़े लैंडलॉर्ड्स हैं या एफ्लुएंट बैकग्राउंड से हैं, आई हैव सीन देम कलैप्सिंग 6 महीने से ज्यादा काम नहीं होता, बिकॉज लॉ इन एक्शन इज एंटायरली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम लॉ इन बुक्स. द रियल टेस्ट इज लिटिगेशन में किसने सर्वाइव करना है. सो मैं ये कहूंगा, सबसे पहला डिसीजन ये होना चाहिए, इज दिस प्रोफेशन फॉर यू और नॉट, द प्रोफेशन ऑफ लॉ. नंबर टू, वॉट काइंड ऑफ वर्क यू वॉन्ट टू डू. कंटेंशियस वर्क करना है, नॉन कंटेंशियस करना है. लिटिगेशन सीखनी है तो बड़ा सबर आजमा पेशा है. द थर्ड क्वेश्चन, विच एरिया ऑफ लॉ यू वॉन्ट टू सेलेक्ट. आपने सिविल करना है, क्रिमिनल करना है, आपने कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल करना है. ऑर्डर अ ड्रिंक विच यू वॉन्ट टू ड्रिंक टिल द एंड, डोंट जस्ट स्टॉप इट. ऑर्डर अ कॉफी और फिर हाफ वे थ्रू आपको मैंने चाय पीनी है, तो यू विल एंड अप ruining your career and affecting your career. Take all the time in the world first to design, to decide what you want to do. And once you take the decision, then there is no turning back, then just look forward. और आपने जो आगे बढ़ना है वो कैसे बढ़ना है, 2 से 3 साल की internship और जो placement है, that is absolutely mandatory. 2 से 3 साल से पहले तो देख सवाल ही नहीं उठता, दैट यू गो सोलो एंड यू सेट अप योर ओन चैम्बर्स एंड योर ओन प्रैक्टिस. 2 से 3 साल के बाद, 3 से 4 साल इज द टाइम विच यू हैव टू स्पेंड इन ऑर्डर टू स्टेबलाइज योर प्रैक्टिस एंड इन ऑर्डर टू बी श्योर. सो 4 से 5 सालों के बाद यहां पर ये दरख्त फल देना शुरू करता है, इन माई हम्बल ओपिनियन एंड इन माई एक्सपीरियंस. सो हमें डिसिप्लिन चाहिए, हमें कमिटमेंट चाहिए स्टूडेंट से और यू नो यंग लॉयर से. स्किल्स जो इम्प्रूव करने, मैं अक्सर ये बात कहता हूं कि पाकिस्तान में स्किल्स के ऊपर यू कैन नॉट वेयर वन सूट. आपको जिसका जो अच्छा मिलता है, अपने उस्ताद से जो अच्छा मिलता है, ट्राई टू एक्वायर दैट. यू गो एंड यू सिट इन द कोर्ट्स, कोई और सीनियर आर्ग्यू कर रहा है, उसका एडवोकेसी स्टाइल पसंद है, केस प्रेजेंटेशन स्टाइल पसंद है, बॉडी लैंग्वेज पसंद है, ड्राफ्टिंग पसंद है, जिसका जो मिलता है वो उठाएं और अडॉप्ट करें. नेटफ्लिक्स से कुछ अच्छा मिलता है वो उठाएं, इंटरनेट से जो अच्छा मिलता है वो उठाएं. बड़े चैलेंजिंग टाइम्स आ गए हैं, अपने आप को सियासत से और पॉलिटिक्स से दूर रखें जहां तक मुमकिन हो सके इन इनिशियल डेज. दैट इज एब्सोल्युटली इंपॉर्टेंट. आई वुड टेक अ पॉज इफ यू नो एनीवन हैज अ क्वेश्चन. आई एम नॉट टू श्योर वेदर यू हर्ड मी ऑल और नॉट, बट आई अप्रिशिएट योर पेशेंस एंड द इनकन्वीनियंस कॉज्ड इन द बिगिनिंग बाय नॉट बीइंग एबल टू हियर मी. ओवर टू यू मैडम.
Thank you so much, sir. We've been hearing you absolutely fine. It has been an extremely concrete and insightful session for all our audience. And for me especially, I've been taking notes. And I think mujhe apna legal ka thoda na map mil raha tha ki 4-5 saal is the timeline that I have framed it in my mind now. Thank you so much, sir. Ramna, you have the floor now. You can pose the next question.
Okay, thank you. So I would like to ask my next question from Ma'am Sara Tarar, which is very relevant as said by Sir Barrister Salman. So we have frequently observed that politicization of the young lawyers. So is that difficult to separate politics from law in today, in current circumstances? Please shed a light on this.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I agree with Salman Saab completely that पॉलिटिक्स और लॉ को मिक्स नहीं करना चाहिए. इट नेवर वर्क्स एंड स्पेशली इन द यंगर ईयर्स यू हैव टू फोकस कम्प्लीटली ऑन योर करियर पाथ. आई ऑल्सो अग्री विद हिम एंड आई मेंशन इन द बिगिनिंग व्हेन आई वाज टॉकिंग एज वेल कि इनिशियली यू हैव टू हैव प्लान योर ईयर्स अहेड. यू हैव टू हैव मेंटर्स इन माइंड. यू नीड टू डू इंटर्नशिप्स. थिंक ऑफ योर एरिया ऑफ स्पेशलाइजेशन. अपनी ग्राउंडिंग आप करें. दिस इज व्हाट आई फील. बट हैविंग सेड दैट, आई फील it depends on what you mean by politicization. ठीक है, is your question politics law से अलग हो सकता है, नहीं हो सकता? I think if you're talking about roles of you know bar associations, they can have a very positive role to play. If ever you know constitution आपकी jeopardy में आती है, lawyers can play a very positive role. उस हद तक politics is a good thing, but mixing up law with politics, especially at initial stage, I would not agree with. Thank you.
Thank you. Ma'am Sana, what would you like to say on this?
Madam Sana, we can have your response and then we can have a Biha's response before we move towards the concluding session.
Sure. So I think that basically this is a sort of top-down order, and what I would like to say is that when junior lawyers would see their seniors actually doing something, they would imitate that behavior. So I think it would start from the seniors not to sort of mix law and politics. And I think that this is something that the juniors would then need to adhere to as well. It comes back to what I said initially about there being this code of conduct, professional ethical framework that needs to be adhered to very strictly. And unless and until the senior lawyers don't follow that, obviously the juniors won't be able to do so as well. So that's all I'll say with regards to that, that whatever the seniors do, the juniors will follow. So the seniors need to set a good example. They need to be role models for juniors to follow.
Thank you very much. Abhiha, since you're also a recent graduate, so you're very close to the pulse also. What according to you, is the youth spirit, the young lawyers, do they want to pursue politics? How do you see the situation?
I have recently been named as one of the members of the Pakistan National Youth Council. But I guess that is not politics. That is basically being sort of a voice for them. And that is what Prime Minister Imran Khan has a project initiated a project. But what I would say is that politics and law are two different things, and it should be kept like that. And for us, obviously, as Sir Salman has already said, that we have around 5 to 6 years in mind to already make a career in law. And once we start stepping up on politics at the same time, I guess it more or less, majorly it compromises our ethics rather than us being involved into politics. Because just we saw last year as well, there was an example of a fight between young lawyers and young medical officers. I guess it's nothing more than compromising your own legal ethics. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all our panelists. Now the session for the questions has elapsed. We'll move towards each of our panelists for their concluding comments and remarks. We'll have Barrister Salman. So anything you want to say, aakhir mein hamare jo audience aapko dekh rahe hain aur jab recording post hogi to mazid dekhenge, aapka kya message hoga unke liye?
सबसे पहले मैं उनसे माफी मांगना चाहूंगा कि वो इतनी देर मेरी जो टेरिबल इंटरनेट कनेक्शन है दे वर ट्राइंग टू पुट अप विद दैट और मैं आपका जो आखिरी सवाल है उसको मैं मजीद एलैबोरेट करूंगा जो यंग लॉयर्स एंड पॉलिटिक्स मैं इसके काफी खिलाफ हूँ फॉर वैरायटी ऑफ रीजंस और इसके बड़े फार रीचिंग कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस हैं एंड आई हैव सीन मेनी यंग लॉयर्स रूइनिंग देयर करियर बाय जॉइनिंग पॉलिटिक्स एट अ वेरी अर्ली स्टेज ये इसको मैं शॉर्टकट बोलूंगा शॉर्टकट टू सक्सेस और आई हैव सीन सो मेनी लॉयर्स यू नो बीइंग सक्सेसफुल in their early days of politics and then becoming psychological cases and then going in depression because when you are in power when you are in politics you are the preferred choice for many litigants and then when you are no more in power nobody wishes to engage you I belong to the traditional school the orthodox school the conventional school ke aapko shuru ke chand saal absolutely you have to distant yourself from political activities. Har cheez ka ek waqt hota hai. So, 4 se 5 saal, your entire focus has to be on learning, the understanding the profession, learning the skills, being disciplined, doing your exercise, striking a balance between learning law and your extracurricular activities, and then 5 se 6 saal, jo कंसिस्टेंसी से रेगुलरिटी से डिसिप्लिन से और पंचुअलिटी से और कमिटमेंट से इस प्रोफेशन में सर्वाइव करेगा 5 सालों के बाद उसको रिजल्ट ऑटोमेटिकली आना जो है वो शुरू हो जाएगा सो मेरा फाइनल मशवरा यही है कि द की टू सक्सेस यू नो लाइज इन हार्ड वर्क और आपके जो स्किल्स हैं आपने उनको कॉन्स्टेंटली यू नो मेक एफर्ट टू इम्प्रूव योर स्किल्स वो चाहे वो इंटरनेट से इम्प्रूव हो रहे हैं चाहे वो रीडिंग से हो रहे हैं चाहे वो ड्राफ्टिंग से हो रहे हैं चाहे वो नेटफ्लिक्स में आप लॉ रिलेटेड प्रोग्राम्स आप देख लें एक बड़ी वैरायटी है अवेलेबल है कोविड ने चीजें बहुत बदल दी हैं, 2 साल इतनी बदली हैं कि हमें आज मजबूर कर दिया है कि हम इंटरनेट के जरिए कॉन्फ्रेंस कर रहे हैं, एंड गॉड नोज फॉर हाउ मेनी यू नो मोर इयर्स दिस विल कंटिन्यू एंड दिस विल यू नो हॉन्ट अस, आई डोंट थिंक इट्स गोइंग एनीवेयर। तो मैं तो यही चाहूंगा कि बड़ी अवेयरनेस के साथ और बड़ी होश के साथ आप अपने प्रोफेशन में, ये बड़ी मेहनत से आप इस स्टेज तक पहुंचते हैं, और मैंने बहुत सारे लोगों के, आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज द रीजन, बड़ी जबरदस्त जहाज आता है, रनवे पे भागता है, टेक ऑफ करता है, और ऑल ऑफ अ सडन धड़ाम यू नो कलैप्स कर जाता है, और बड़े बड़े चंद एक लोग हैं जो सरवाइव यू नो कर पाते हैं। और खवातीन के लिए भी मैं जरूर कुछ कहना चाहूंगा, आई एम डिलाइटेड टू सी यू नो टू बी अमंगस्ट 5 ladies एंड ऑल 5 ऑफ यू माशाल्लाह, यू स्पीक सो वेल, यू आर डूइंग सो वेल, और आप सब ने यू हैव प्रूव्ड योर यू नो मेटल। एक ये बड़ी दिक्कत है, द ब्राइटेस्ट स्टूडेंट्स दैट आई हैव टॉट इन द पास्ट 20 years आर ऑल फीमेल्स, एंड इट डिसअपॉइंट्स मी व्हेन आई डोंट सी देम इन देयर रिस्पेक्टिव करियर्स, less than 5%। मगर एक चीज जो मैं देख रहा हूं गुज़िश्ता 2 सालों में कि ख़वातीन कमबैक कर रही हैं अपना, यू नो फैमिली इज इम्पॉर्टेंट बट योर प्रोफेशन इज ऑल्सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, द कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। सो ख़वातीन को मैं देख रहा हूं कि वो वापस आ रही हैं और उनको वापस आना चाहिए, और बहुत कम लोग हैं जो लिटिगेशन की तरफ आ रहे हैं। सो बींग अ लिटिगेटर, हम तो यही कहते हैं कि यू नो एज अ बैरिस्टर हम प्रेफर करते हैं कि कंटेंशियस वर्क हो रादर देन नॉन कंटेंशियस वर्क। सो ज्यादा से ज्यादा ख्वातीन को और लड़कियों को भी जो है वो इस प्रोफेशन में आना चाहिए। सो बाकी मेरी बहनों के लिए मौका कि वो अपना हिस्सा डालें इन कंक्लूडिंग रिमार्क्स।
थैंक यू सर। सो आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क फ्रॉम मैम सारा कि आप अपने कंक्लूडिंग रिमार्क्स दे दें काइंडली।
Thank you so much, and thank you so much, Salman Saab. It was a pleasure to listen to all that you said, especially in your concluding remarks. I think I agree with most of the things you talked about, such as skill building and such as women coming into the profession. So I think I did not get a chance to talk about one or two things, and both Salman Saab ne kuch mentioned bhi ki, I think that is something I need to talk about as my going comments. As a student, I choose your law college wisely, not just your mentors. I mentioned mentors before. That's why now I'm talking about the law college. Why? Because I feel, especially aap chahe local LLB background se hain ya aap University of London background se hain, you have to see what kind of gaps do you need to bridge. If you're, for instance, from a local LLB background and you have legal, writing skills ka issue hai, so you need to work on those. If you're from University of London LLB background, you unfortunately lack the knowledge jo local LLB ka hona chahiye. And like Salman saab said, ye nahi ho sakta ki ek week ka aap ek trial case inhe kara dein ya aap inhe booting kara dein, that is sufficient. It has to be continuous practice. 3 saal ek college aapko kya kara raha hai, in those 3 years see what you can gain from that college. Are they focusing on bridging the gap? Are you making sure you are in touch with actual lawyers who are working in the field? So for instance, you think internship करके कि मुझे company law की specialization में जाना है, आपको पता क्या उसके बारे में? Are there any seminars being provided? Are there any legal workshops being provided? आपकी generally speaking drafting skills, ठीक है? So ये जो सारी legal skills हैं जो एक lawyer की होनी चाहिए, जो local knowledge है, for instance आपका law GAT और CE का exam तो होता है, how many institutions actually take the pains to prepare their students for law GAT and CE exams? बच्चे end में थोड़ा बहुत रट के इधर उधर देख के कर लेते हैं, बट आपने अगर लोकल एलएलबी नहीं किया, इज देयर समथिंग बीइंग डन टू मेक श्योर टू इंश्योर कि आपको उसमें भी कुछ कराया जा रहा है, नॉट जस्ट कि जी आप एग्जाम दे दें एंड दे जस्ट लीव यू इन डीप वाटर। सो आई थिंक ऑल ऑफ दीज थिंग्स आर थिंग्स टू लुक एट। एंड सलमान साहब मेंशनड यू नो कि नहीं समझ आता कि व्हाट हैपेंस, एकदम से एक फ्लाइट होती है एंड देन धड़ाम यू नो गॉन। आई फील मुझे जो फैक्टर नजर आता है, इट्स अबाउट you jump too quickly. I feel you have to go slow and steady and don't compare yourself to others. Everyone has their own pace. So I think some students and some young lawyers are very full of energy, but wo energy mein burn out kar jate hain, apne aap ko slow steady nahi rakhte. This is my take on it. I might be wrong, but I feel it's very important to be slow and steady. As far as the women are concerned, yeah, go on Ramna.
Continue, ma'am. As we are left with few minutes, so I thought we should move forward. So please continue.
So as far as the women are concerned, I will just quickly just finish this topic here, that you know, we need to facilitate women, not just in law firms, but also in law colleges. We should see that they are provided with daycare. They need to be able to take the, you know, not be concerned about their family. This is what stops them from moving forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Absolutely. Very rightly said. So I will move to Ma'am Sana, and after that, Ma'am Abiha. So we'll, after that, Hania will conclude the session. Over to you, Ma'am Sana.
So I just have some concluding remarks to make. Firstly, so when we're looking at the skills for junior lawyers or young lawyers, it all boils down to their relationship or a lawyer's relationship with their clients. And I really should emphasize this, that you need to be very sensitive to your clients. You need to develop counseling skills alongside your legal skills. You need to have the ability to listen patiently to your clients, to be able to empathize with your clients. Now, these are very basic points that we as lawyers should possess, but you'll often find that not only junior lawyers but senior lawyers also tend to not possess these qualities. I apologize, I think that there's some echoing. Can everybody actually hear what I'm saying?
We can hear you.
There's some sort of echo behind your voice.
Yeah, sorry, I really don't know where did that come from. Apart from that, there needs to be gender sensitivity and cultural sensitivity, because in Pakistan as well, we have a diversity of different cultures. Gender sensitivity itself is a massive issue in Pakistan, and especially in the legal field. Those are the sort of things that young lawyers need to be trained about at that initial stage. And apart from that, of course, the usual things of them being flexible, non-judgmental. Those are my concluding remarks. And again, I will emphasize this, I've been saying it throughout the course of this webinar, ke a code of conduct jo hai wo hona bahut zaruri hai, and it's essential for everybody, chahe koi senior ho, chahe junior ho, ke us code of conduct ke hisab se kaam kare. Aur agar koi bhi issue arise hota hai, to immediately action us pe lena zaruri hai. Thank you.
Thank you, Ma'am Sana. So over to you, Ma'am Biha. What would you like to say at the end of the session for the audience?
Mere tino jo mentors ki jagah hai, teachers ki jagah hai, I'm very honored to be amongst them right now. And mujhe itna koi zyada pata nahi hai itne bade bade logon ke darmiyan baith ke bolne ka. But my concluding remarks would be that first, we need to really focus that students ko in the university practical knowledge provide ki jaye, aur practical cases par hame kaam karne ka mauka diya jaye jo bhi students hain. And secondly, as Sir Salman already said, that students ke andar inculcate karne ki bahut zyada zarurat hai, that there is no shortcut. हम लोग देखते हैं दैट अभी थर्ड ईयर स्टूडेंट होता नहीं है, वो अब्बा जी के चैम्बर में जाके बैठा होता है, वो किसी चाचा के साथ कोई हाई कोर्ट में खड़े होके अपने साथ ऑलरेडी एक एडवोकेट और हाई कोर्ट और क्या क्या लगाकर स्टेटसेस पोस्ट कर रहा होता है. सो आई गेस दैट इज द वेरी माइंडसेट जो अब हमारे मेजोरिटी स्टूडेंट्स के अंदर मैं देख रही हूँ. प्लस अब मेरी लॉ से हट के थोड़ी सी ये भी आइडेंटिटी है दैट आई प्ले फुटबॉल फॉर द पाकिस्तान नेशनल फुटबॉल टीम फ्रॉम द पास्ट 12 ईयर्स नाउ. और अब कोई 12-13 साल के बाद व्हेन people know me around the world, so that is uske piche pure 11-12 saal ki mehnat hai, aur international awards hain, national awards hain jo maine puri duniya mein hasil kiye hain for Pakistan. So I guess slow and steady wins the race. Of course, aap jitna zyada patiently apna hard work karoge, you be humble and you just stick to your own goals, and sky's the limit. So there is no shortcut for anything at all.
Thank you so much. Yeah, slow and steady wins the race. So over to you, Hania.
I would also extend my heartiest and most sincere gratitude to all the panelists. It has been an extremely enriching, invigorating, and eye-opening session for me, for Ramna, and for all our audience. In the end, I can just say that I couldn't have asked for a better and more dynamic panel. I'm sure our audience who tuned into the session also duly enjoyed and benefited from this. I, on behalf of YG, extend my most sincere gratitude and absolute appreciation to the entire panel, Barrister Salman Safdar, Madam Sara Tarin, Madam Anna, and Madam Abiha. Thank you so much for your time. I would also thank our partners in the end, Courting the Law, Kapil Dhan, Law, the Games of Law, Adilar Sahid, Center for Human Rights, and Women Law Initiative. Inshallah, we'll also join again, hopefully next time in person. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye.